Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. I'm Nick Barber. This week I'm in Vancouver for the Computer-Human Interaction Conference, and we're going to talk about those projects in just a bit. First with this week's top news. On Monday in San Francisco, Microsoft announced plans to acquire Skype for $8.5 billion. Microsoft CEO Steve Ballmer told us why.
We're irrepressible in moving forward and pursuing new things. We've been consistently focused on empowering consumers and businesses to do more with technology. This Skype acquisition is entirely consistent with our ambitious, forward-looking, irrepressible nature.
He said the company plans to optimize Skype for TV with the Xbox and Kinect, and for the Windows Phone and Windows PC. He also pointed out that there are 170 million Skype users with a 40% year-on-year growth. He was emphatic, though, that Microsoft won't monopolize Skype.
We will continue to support non-Microsoft platforms because it's fundamental to the value proposition of communication.
Once the deal is approved, Skype will become a division of Microsoft headed by Skype CEO Tony Bates. Google announced this week that the first Chromebooks will go on sale June 15th to the U.S. and seven other countries. They run Google's Chrome OS and use cloud-based storage and applications.
It has a 12.1-inch display. It looks great. It's a 300-nit display, and the web looks great on it. It has all-day battery usage. So you literally, I've used it for many days now. You don't run out of battery while you use it during the day. So it has an 11.6-inch screen, so it's easy to carry around. It's a full HD display, and but they work to fit in a full-size keyboard so that you can easily carry it around. It'd be very, very productive on this machine. I should mention that the Samsung device will be priced at $429 for the Wi-Fi option with the built-in 3G option and 100 megs free built-in. It is $499 in the United States. The Acer device, it's an incredible value. It's priced starting at $349 and up.
Consumers will be able to buy the systems at retail stores and online, and they'll also be offered for businesses and schools on a per-month service plan that includes replacement units. Here at the Computer-Human Interaction Conference in Vancouver, more than 2,500 researchers have gathered to exchange their ideas. One of the first things I saw here at the show was the paper phone, a flexible e-ink display that its creators think could soon replace the smartphone. The paper phone can recognize 10 unique bends or gestures, and the team hopes to add more as they develop the device further. For now, the phone is tethered to a laptop which runs the software. The team would like to disconnect the phone as well as make the screen more durable. Researchers from Texas A&M University have created an inexpensive multi-touch system made of infrared sensors, similar to what's used in television remote controls. It can be mounted on a desktop, over top a computer screen, or it can hang in the air.
So Zero Touch is sort of a novel optical multi-touch sensor. It enables multi-touch interaction as well as precision free air interaction. And I like to consider it as kind of this optical force field. It's like a picture frame, if you imagine, where we shoot thousands of light beams across and we can detect anything that intersects that frame.
The frame is lined with 256 IR sensors, and you can see on this computer screen what it looks like when you interact with the system. If Zero Touch is mounted over top of a computer screen, it turns a traditional monitor into a multi-touch surface. Taken one step further, if the screen is suspended, then a user could paint a virtual canvas. The colors are controlled using an iPhone, and the thickness of the brush is controlled by how much enters the frame. For the next part of the project, the team plans to stack the frames so they can perceive depth. Human-computer interaction pioneer Bill Buxton was here and brought with him 30 years of technology, gadgets, and gizmos. Some that have failed, some that have succeeded, all of which the industry has learned from. He had mice on display, keyboards, tablets, and iPods, among other devices. He talked about the iPod design and its influences.
Right. Well, Jonathan Ive, who designed this, has a hero too. His name is John Dieter Rams, who was the head of design at Braun. And this is a radio, still working, quite rare. So it's got a scroll wheel too, to tune it, okay? So I won't subject you to the pain of the noise, but I just want. And notice the shape, the basic color, the form factor, proportions, the display, And you say, but that's not a display, that's a loudspeaker. No, no, that's a display. It's an acoustic display, generically. And the display is in the same position with the scroll wheel, and so on and so forth. And you realize that this is a quote based on that, which, by the way, is not, this is how all design is. This is a brilliant thing.
The project is called Frictional Widgets, and what it's designed to do is make your screen slippery at some points and sticky at others. Imagine if you're dragging a folder and the screen is slippery. Then suddenly it becomes sticky when it hits its destination. That's the idea behind another project here at CHI.
The screen itself has four piezoelectric actuators. These just shake the piece of glass. They make it vibrate. This is actually the same technology that's used in many cell phones or other devices, but it runs at higher frequencies, so you don't feel the vibration itself. But it pushes your finger away from the piece of glass, and a bit like an air hockey table, it will push your finger off and make it more slippery. So by changing the amplitude of this vibration, we can make the piece of glass feel very sticky or very slippery.
The prototype is quite bulky now and uses lasers to determine the position of the finger. The research team would like to make the whole project smaller and wants to replace the lasers with capacitive sensing. I got a chance to try it out, and it does actually work. It's really impressive. And before we sign off, one of the most interesting projects here at CHI. It's called the Humaniquarium. Inside are the musicians and performers, and outside is the audience that can interact with the exhibit.
The system is a transparent piece of acrylic at the front. The window you may be able to see down here, which we're using as a touch interface. So we shine infrared into the sides of the acrylic, and then when you touch it, that lights up your finger and the camera sees your finger lit up. So it's, the camera sees lots of bright points and goes, that's lots of points. And we then use those points to affect various audio effects and visual effects within the performance piece. So the lighting on the outside, the audio processes on Robin's voice, on the mandolin, the keyboard synths, panning, all sorts of various different effects.
The team has a background in both music and technology, which has obviously helped them greatly in this project. They're already working on their next one that replaces human performers with robots. Well, that's our show for this week. Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. Be sure to check out the Facebook fan page for a look at my video diaries from the trip. Next week, I'll be back in Boston with all of the latest tech news, so be sure to tune in. As we head out this week, we'll leave you with some sights of Vancouver. I'm Nick Barber, and for all of us here at the IDG News Service, thanks for watching. We hope to see you next week.